speaking to the middle of Daniel that you've been following through. It was an encouragement for me to get it out and read it again. We've been working through John's Gospel and Rothley, so it was great to dive into Daniel. And whenever I read it, I'm struck by how relevant it is to the everyday life of Christians. In one sense, what the kind of story we've got here in this chapter is straight out of today's headlines, isn't it? We've got intrigue and witch hunts at the very heart of government, which is exactly what I think I read in the newspaper yesterday, although one of the MPs apparently declared that it wasn't a witch hunt, but I'm not convinced. In many ways, what Daniel faced as a believer in the Lord, living in exile, is bang up to date with the situation of the Christian believer today. We're told in the scriptures, aren't we, in the New Testament, that Christians, like Daniel, are exiles and strangers. That's the language Peter uses when he addresses the Christians in his letter. We're living in the world, but we're not of the world. And how can Christian faith survive in that situation, particularly when society, and government in particular, is increasingly hostile, and laws are passed to force Christian faith to retreat into just a public faith, and especially forcing any leader who is a Christian, anybody who wants to stand up in the public place and argue for anything which comes from their Christian faith, is forced to either submit to silence or get out of the public square. During my lifetime, all sorts of things have happened. I can remember way back in the early 80s, Sunday trading. Then there was a whole debate about whether doctors had the right to refuse an abortion. Adoption agencies, as to whether or not if potential adoptees express a clear Christian faith, they can adopt children. Registrars, whether they're prepared or if they're able to work without having to register marriages that in conscience they do not believe to be true marriages. Prayers before council meetings. One could go on. Symbols of faith in public life. Over the last 20, 30 years, there's just been a gradual ratcheting up of the pressure whereby any public display of faith, we are told, submit or we will move you out. We will get rid of you from the public place. And of course that filters down to us all, because every time we read in the headlines in the newspapers that somebody has, in a sense like Daniel, stood against governmental pressure in this way to silence their faith, anyone who stood against that, when we then see how they are treated in the media, the immediate sort of outpouring of anger and vitriol against them, whether on social media or within the more sort of general public press, that again affects us. When we next go to work, when we are next with our family member who doesn't share our faith, and we find the pressure to silence ourselves and not to stand up for what we actually believe in. And so we compartmentalize faith, and we get into this position that while I believe such and such, well, of course, at work, I can't live that out. I can't speak about that. I can't argue for that. That's not allowed. And so we live in compartments and separate that, and our integrity begins to break down. So this famous story about Daniel in the lion's den, I think, speaks right into the kind of situations that we face seeking to live as Christians in our world today. So what's it really about? Well, the first five verses really introduce to life working for the new boss. Belshazzar, if you remember him from chapter 5, who was the Babylonian emperor, is dead. And Darius, the Persian, the Mede, he's taken over the kingdom. And he needs to bring order and organization to his new empire. There's been a change of government, basically. And what will happen, therefore, to Daniel under this new regime? Daniel, a Jewish exile, under the previous regime, under Belshazzar, he hadn't withdrawn and separated from society. In fact, in chapter 5, verse 29, we read that Daniel had been promoted by Belshazzar to being the third highest ruler in the land. So now the new government's in. Where's Daniel's loyalties going to lie? Can he be trusted? I mean, we know whenever a new government comes in, even if it's a government of the same political party, there's a new broom. Sweep out the old. Get rid of the old cabinet. Bring in a new one. Surely Darius is going to want to do the same and to reward and promote his own people. Well, maybe he does, because we read that he begins by appointing 120 satraps, regional governors. But surprisingly, Daniel, from the old regime, is kept on as one of the chief ministers. In this new situation, under the new boss, rather than being resentful and things were better than under the old regime, Daniel, himself by now probably an older man who should be looking forwards to winding down to retirement in the country, rolls up his sleeves and gets stuck in to working for the new government. We read he so distinguished himself. He had exceptional qualities. He was utterly trustworthy. And so Darius plans, in verse 3, to set him, this guy from the old government, over the whole nation. Can you imagine that in our context? After a general election, the prime minister decides that his right-hand man is going to be someone from the government, a leading minister from the government he has just defeated. And it's laughable, isn't it? That's what's actually going on here with Daniel. So we have Darius's newly promoted cronies, these 120 satraps, loyally rewarded, enjoying his patronage, really are provoked to envy. Daniel's not one of us. He's the old guard. How can he be promoted above us? They try desperately to find some grounds for undermining Daniel, but there are no chinks in his integrity. And there's a real challenge to us, I think, in this. What reputation do you have amongst your colleagues as a Christian in your place of work? Do they say, that person is really trustworthy? Does they say about you, there is no question of any corruption or negligence? They say about you, so in the language of Ephesians chapter 6, this guy, when he's in charge of us, treats us as if we were children of God. Or this guy, when he's working for us, doesn't only do his job when we're watching him, but even when we're not watching him, he does his job and goes the extra mile. Because that's what we're called to as Christians. And that's what Daniel is clearly doing. It is not uncommon for Christians, because of their integrity, to be promoted and envied by their colleagues. So what happens when they all turn against you? Well, in verses 6 to 18, we see that Christians serve a higher authority. They can't get rid of Daniel because of any failure in his work, so they settle upon a plan that both attacks Daniel at the one place he can't compromise, and they appeal to the new king's vanity and insecurity. O King Darius, live forever, they all sycophantically say to Darius. Now, wouldn't it be a good idea to secure your authority across the whole kingdom, across the whole empire? that rather than people going to their own gods with their requests and so on, let them all come and pray to you and bring all of their requests to you. You want to be thought of as a listening king, don't you? Everyone will love you. Why don't you just pass an edict and say, for 30 days, everybody, whatever's not right in their lives, let them bring it to you rather than praying to their own gods. They'll love you all the more for that. What a great idea, Darius thought. Won't I be popular and well thought of? So he walks straight into this trap and passes an irrevocable law that effectively outlaws Daniel's faith for 30 days. To break it, Daniel won't just get the sack, he'll go in the lion's den. Now, I wonder how might we react were we in that situation? Because this is the kind of reasoning that I think I'm susceptible to, and I've heard lots of people express when this kind of pressure has been turned on them. In my place of work, I've got to be in there to be a witness. In order to win these people for Christ, I've got to be in there. And so it's really important that I don't lose my position. So for the sake of the long-term benefits, for these 30 days, I'm just going to shut up. Now, that can be an attractive way of thinking. I can still pray behind locked doors or in my head. God will understand. And so we begin that stage of compromise and withdrawal. We accept the pressure. We shut up. But the problem is, once the 30 days are over, we've formed the habit. We've got used to living that way. And then it is much harder ever to stand up for our faith again. What we learn from Daniel here is that we serve a higher authority than the boss, whether he be the emperor or whoever. Yes, we live in Babylon, the symbolic city organized in opposition to God, but Babylon has no enduring future. Jerusalem is the eternal city, which may at the time of Daniel appear to be a heap of rubble, just as sometimes when we look out of the church and think, yeah, the church is in a mess, it's in a wasteland. But we serve a higher authority. And so Daniel, rather than submitting, in verse 10, as was his custom, he kneels and prays towards Jerusalem, towards that heap of rubble that looks so pathetic and insignificant in the eyes of those running the empire. And he prays three times a day, just as he always has. He is a loyal servant of Darius, but if Darius claims the honor that is due only to God, he must defy that edict, whatever the cost. And that's been a stand that Christians have been called to make through the ages. Duncan began by referring to the words of Latimer. You know, he was a local boy, Latimer from Thurkston, grew up in Thurkston. Luther, who Leonie referred to, when in front of the emperor he was summoned and demanded that he recant what he was teaching about Jesus. He basically said, unless you can prove I am wrong by scripture, here I stand, I can do no other, so help me God. A monk before the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. And Cranmer, the writer of the Book of Common Prayer, on which our Anglican Church is founded, before those who were about to take him to be burned, this is what he said. And it's a slightly longer quote, but listen carefully to what he said, because he what he said. And now I come to the great thing that troubleth my conscience more than any other thing that I ever said or did in my life. And that is this, the setting abroad of writings contrary to the truth, which here I renounce and refuse as things written with my hand contrary to the truth, which I believed in my heart. And I wrote for fear of death and to save my life, if it might be. And that is all such writings which I have written or signed with my hand since my torture, wherein I have written many things untrue. And for as much as my hand offended in writing contrary to what I truly believed in my heart, therefore my hand shall first be punished. For if I may come to the fire, it shall first be burned. And so when he was taken to the stake to be burned, he put his hand into the flames first, the hand with which he had been forced to write these things contrary to what he believed in his heart. So we have a great tradition in the Christian church of people standing up when the emperor has demanded of us what is only due to God. And so the question is, for us as believers, you know, we may not be promoted to being the chief minister in the government, but where will it hit us? Maybe it is wearing a simple Christian symbol at work. Maybe it is speaking up for something or against something at work or in our families. For me, one of the places I come across it is with the relentless promotion of a multi-faith and pluralist agenda through education in schools. Now, even in our church schools, we have to stand up against that kind of pluralism, which is just assumed as being the norm. There's pressures are put on just thinking of next weekend with remembrance. Pressures to speak in generalities of God and people of faith rather than to speak of Jesus Christ. There's a whole number of things which is sort of coming down the road. Do pray for Christian ministers. We're going to be at the sharp end of a lot of this over the years to come, where governments pass rules which with integrity we cannot implement. But back to Daniel, the chief ministers and the satraps are delighted with Daniel's stand because he's walked straight into their trap as far as they can see. They rush to Darius, gloatingly reminding him of his irrevocable edict, and they see Daniel thrown into the lion's den. And we read that the emperor, who had promoted Daniel because he was so loyal, so trustworthy, so had such integrity, the emperor, Darius, is distraught. And he prays to Daniel's own God, despite his edict. May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you. And then he lies awake all night, refusing to join in the chief minister's victory party. And so lastly, we see that in a strange land, God rescues and vindicates his people. We come now to the famous lion's den. What will become of Daniel? And it is actually quite a comical scene at dawn, that next day, isn't it? The king crying out by the lion's den, "Is there anybody in there? Servant of the living God, has the living God whom you serve continually been able to rescue you?" What did Darius expect to hear? The contented snoring of beasts after a good meal. "May the king live forever," he declares. "My God," Daniel declares, "my God sent his angel and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight, nor have I done any wrong before you, your majesty." So Daniel is brought out and his false accusers and their families are thrown in. The lions were evidently still hungry. vindicated Daniel by Darius, issuing this new decree, declaring the promises and the glories and the praises of a rescuing God. He is the living God. He endures forever. His kingdom will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on the earth. He's rescued Daniel from the power of the lions. So what should we conclude from all of this in the challenges that we face? Clearly, not every believer who stands for his faith against the prevailing authorities is delivered. We've seen that in the example of Cranmer and of Ridley and Latimer, the Reformation martyrs. Plenty of other Christians went to the lions under Roman persecution and weren't delivered then and there. Plenty of Christians are killed today. Others lose their jobs. The tribunals, the courts decide against them. In our congregation, a registrar has been forced to resign over the whole issue of same-sex marriages. And a couple have been refused the possibility of adoption over their stance on the Christian faith. But unlike Daniel, we look back on the cross and the resurrection. And we know that death, even at the teeth of lions, is a hollow victory for the persecutors. Daniel points the way ahead to that ultimate vindication. The world, the flesh and the devil threw everything they had at our Lord Jesus Christ. And it looked like they'd won. But they hadn't. God vindicated Jesus Christ and raised him from the dead. And what that means for us is that God is always faithful. Death will never have the last word. And death would not have had the last word if the lions had eaten Daniel either, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus himself said, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell." We have a God who will ultimately vindicate us who are in Jesus Christ, whatever the challenges we face. So where was the real lion's den? Where was the really voracious appetite to destroy Daniel? It wasn't with the big golden pussycats, but it was in the workplace. That's where the real lions were. And it is there that God reigns and will vindicate those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the way you vindicated Daniel in this situation, as a foreshadowing of your far greater and more glorious